Okay, great. We're going to make a start, everyone. Welcome to Occupy Documentary, Can Filmmakers Be Activists? I'm Charlie Phillips. I'm the Marketplace Director at Sheffield DocFest, moonlighting as the chair of this panel. I'm very happy to be here. Thanks, everyone, for coming. Excuse my very hoarse voice. This is what being at DocFest does to you. The last 12 months or so have seen things like the Occupy movement, the Arab Spring, and a whole load of uprisings around the world. And we've been very fascinated in Sheffield at what role documentary plays in that, not just in terms of screening the films and not just in terms of getting people to make small adjustments to their lifestyle, but how documentary can actually change dominant economic systems and actually change the way that massive numbers of people live their lives, if documentary can do that at all. And of course, we've had a very real example of the power that documentary can have to scare even the biggest countries and organisations with the news about the Chinese delegation pulling out of the festival this year in response to the Ai Weiwei film. We really believe in the power of documentary, but we're also interested in how documentary makers themselves can be activists and what it means when someone who is a documentary maker on the one hand, but also an activist of whatever extent on the other hand, how those things can work together and what that means if you're trying to build a sustainable career as a factual filmmaker or as a journalist working with factual media. So we have a very distinguished panel here. One member is missing, so the empty chair isn't just in mourning for the kind of change that needs to happen in the world. We will be joined by Brian Knappenberger, the director of We Are Legion, at some point in the, maybe next 10 to 15 minutes. We'll see. He'll run in and seize the chair. I'm going to introduce the panelists one by one, and they'll be telling us a bit about their filmmaking practice and maybe a bit about their view of activism, whether personal or general. So we're going to start with Emily James to my left. Yes, you knew you were going first, right?
No, I didn't, but that's fine.
Okay, Emily James is going first. I'll pad while she gets ready.
I think we'll start. Which clip do we want to start with? Are we going to show both clips?
I think we're going to show both clips, yeah,
all right.
If that's cool. Yeah, so Emily James is probably known to a lot of you as the director of Just Do It, which was a wonderful film about environmental direct action activists that we showed last year. Was it last year?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was last year. And she's also made The Luckiest Nut in the World and lots of other wonderful stuff. And
I made this feature documentary about climate activists, and because I never remember to do this ever, I'm going to do this at the beginning. This is the email sign-up sheet, so if you're interested, please put your email down here and you'll find out about it. Can you stick that into the audience somewhere?
Yeah.
I made this film about activists, and ever since I made a film about activists, I'm now called an activist filmmaker, and it slightly pisses me off and annoys me because I was a filmmaker for 15 years before that, and nobody ever called me that before. And I think I was as much of an activist then as I am now, and I'm not really kind of an activist in that sense, although I liked the way that Tim defined it this morning, so maybe I fit that earlier in the panel, and maybe I fit that description. I became a documentary filmmaker because I wanted to contribute to the dialogue about where we were going as a race and a society and a culture, and I wanted to be part of that, and I thought this was a way that I could do that in a kind of meaningful manner that would also, you know, educate and entertain me. So that's kind of what I did. And like Charlie said, I made a lot of films that were nothing like this, and now I've sort of started making these kinds of films, and I hopefully won't get stuck making them. I decided that I wanted to make a film about Climate Camp and Plain Stupid and a few of these other direct action groups, and they were all groups that I had some vague contact with already, and I knew kind of people who were involved, and so I knew enough to know that they were never going to say yes unless I kind of worked out how to do it safely for them. And also it was a culture that was incredibly hostile to cameras and to the media, to any media. And so like climate camp, the first climate camp I went to, there were no cameras allowed at all whatsoever during the entire camp, and there is no documentation of that camp. And slowly that began to kind of open up a little bit, and people started agreeing to limited, you know, two-hour windows in which you were allowed to film. And the first camp that I filmed in was under these restrictions of like two-hour windows. And I got a huge amount of hostility, both from the police who stopped and searched me 40 times and impounded my car, and from the activists that I was trying to film who treated me with nothing but hostility throughout the entire week of the camp. And it was really quite horrific, harrowing experience. And my friend and kind of camera mate that was on that trip with me, when he ended up seeing Just Do It 3 years later, and he came up to me afterwards and he just said, I can't believe you kept going after that week that we spent at climate camp. That was horrible. And I was like, yeah, I think I'm just really stubborn. So one of the things that I did in order to like try and resolve the problem was I really respected the reasons in a sense why people were asking for there not to be cameras in the camps. I understood their kind of concerns, and I did, you know, I respected that. But I also felt like there was another point of view that they should be seeing, which was about the long-term effect of what they were trying to do and whether people were ever going to hear about it or not. And, you know, that was a relatively straightforward kind of situation. But I didn't want to push against people. I wanted to work with them. So I started getting quite involved with the climate camp media teams and kind of getting involved with what essentially formed out of that was a group that I was very involved with, which was called the Climate Camp Documenting Team, which we were this sort of nebulous, we weren't part of the camp, we were like next to the camp and inside but fully autonomous and, you know, all this stuff. And one of the things that we did was a project called Climate Camp TV. And Climate Camp TV, and this is what you're going to see as one of the pieces that we put out. So during the Blackheath camp, we had our own little tent and our own little like autonomous media zone. And we managed to film and edit and put out a series of, I think we made 72 programs during the week. But not all of them. Some of them were documentary like this, and some of them were like live studio shows. And we created a kind of completely independent TV studio in the middle of the camp, and it was fun, and it became a kind of like game. And it allowed me to build a relationship with the campers and to kind of have a role in the camp and stuff. And then alongside that, I was filming for what would become Just Do It. So, but this is kind of the kind of things that we made. That was a really long-winded introduction, sorry, but...
This is good. Okay, so let's have the pedal-powered smoothies, please.
This is food that we got from a fruit market that was going to waste, that was like being put into a big scoop in a truck and was being taken to landfill to biogas generation. And it's about a 20th of the food that's thrown away every day. So we're just coming here to feed people, but also a platform to show how much waste is generated.
And so we brought all this fruit to the camp, and we've just rigged off a smoothie machine to the back of a bike here, which is just mechanically driven. And now we have smoothies. Cheers.
Can we pause it?
The funniest thing about that action was that it was really sweet what they were doing and stuff, but actually, like, there were a lot of actions that happened at that camp that week, and that was one of the more illegal things that happened that week. and you know, there was lots of, like, if it had come out, the guy who had given them the fruit from the back of the center where they had gotten in, and all this kind of stuff, you know. So we could probably just go in and play the trailer. So in case you've not seen it and don't know about the project, here's the trailer for Just Do It.
Thank you. to fucking do it. We've got a planet, we've got 4 D-Lops.
I put my body in the way and I don't mind being arrested.
Having the fear of God put into me by the climate science, like, it scared the crap out of me, I'm not going
to
lie.
It's become really clear to me what the most urgent things that I need to be doing are.
It's all about taking direct action, making the changes that you want to see happen.
Enough's enough, we've got to start actually doing stuff.
We're upsetting them, making it difficult for them to work. We're quite right.
Lots of getting arrested, running around, hiding, escaping.
Don't worry about climate change, just keep shopping, you're doing the right thing.
I care about this. I'm a citizen of this world.
What we do have a choice about is the future now.
You always got to have hope, and if you don't try, then you never know.
Take action. Just do it.
I want to feel like I'm doing something rather than nothing, and not just watching the world go to shit.
Go on, just do it.
Awesome, thanks, Emily. So there's lots of things to discuss arising from that, but we're going to go next on to Daniel Garvin, to my left. So, actually, why don't you introduce yourself rather than me leading into you?
Okay. I guess different to Emily, I've been more on the activist side of things. So for the last 7 years, I've been more or less full-time involved in activism on different levels, and at local, sort of more community level, national and international level. Started in university, banging my head against a brick wall, trying to do things like boycott Coca-Cola and things like that. And then I got involved with Climate Camp, which we've just seen, and I started a project in France, in Calais, working with refugees. Me and a few others then started UK Uncut, and I've been doing various other things since then. And then more recently, in the past 6 months, I've been, I don't know, getting quite tired of activism, to be honest, and I want a new challenge. And I think an extension of my activism and telling stories and trying to change things is filmmaking, and I've been doing photography for quite a few years, so I finally saved enough money to get a camera that actually films. So I've just made my first film. It's free. There's a whole box of it here if you want it. It's 24 minutes. Just all about the cuts. Basically, you know, as an activist, I'm always trying to get people to tell the story that I want to tell. You know, the media, come on, meet this person, how bad is it, you know, and trying to represent what I think. And I just kind of got fed up and wanted for me to tell the story that I wanted to tell. And hopefully this film is an example of that. So yeah, I've just finished that film. I'm still doing activism, but maybe I'm going to tone it down a little bit. And I'm just beginning to research hopefully my next film on workers' cooperatives. So yeah, that's me. Awesome. And then the film here is a really bad first trailer of the film here. So, I mean, yeah. I hadn't finished it, I had to rush, sorry.
Cool, let's run the clip.
She's been told to use a nappy and she's not incontinent. She's got to deliberately soil herself because they won't provide care for her at night because of government cuts. That's the reality of the cuts on us as disabled people.
$20 million. Well, for 20 years, that little escaped money could keep these libraries open. Now, what's just, what's fair? Goldman Sachs having $20 million, or people having these services for the next 20 years.
All of this will be flattened under the current proposals.
Quality secondary school, and frankly, if you don't mind getting out of my face, I'd appreciate that.
Why are you worried about it?
Not only were they part responsible for this financial crisis, but they're being let off up to £20 million in tax.
This is a political agenda. You can either choose to crack down on tax evasion or tax avoidance, or you can choose to cut back on public services.
So you've got your box of DVDs there. Are you releasing it for free?
It is free. It was critically acclaimed on Twitter yesterday. So yeah, if there's only like 30 odd copies, so otherwise just try and find it online.
Cool. So we'll return to Annie in a moment. But to my right, we have Leah Borromeo. And again, you introduce yourself. I'm not going to talk about you.
Really?
Yeah. Well, I think people have got your bio in the catalogue.
Have they? Oh,
yeah.
Shit.
So I'm not going to repeat it.
Oh fuck. Okay. I've managed to say shit and fuck in under 5 seconds. Long may it continue. My name is Leah Borromeo. I'm a journalist, come film dabbler. I've spent the best part of the decade in corporate media, sort of as sort of foreign editor at Sky News and other places, for my sins. Also leading a kind of double life as a situationist activist and artist type person. And one day that all came to a head when a bunch of friends and I decided to roll into the G20 at a couple of years ago in 2009 on top of an armoured personnel carrier and parked it in front of the Royal Bank of Scotland. It was painted blue, had black and white checkered livery. I was on a riot helmet, wearing my bra, straddling the turret. The tank was blaring Ride of the Valkyries and had fake CCTV cameras around it. And we were all arrested for two counts of impersonating a police officer with intent to deceive, and charged. So that kind of put pay to my end of my career with Rupert Murdoch. If you want some secret stories, let me later. But that also kind of launched me into what most sort of failed, or rather fallen journalists end up doing, is falling into documentary. and I kind of enjoy that, because somehow I kind of fluked into creating 10, or I have a commission to create 10 short films on arts activism for Channel 4, and started doing more work for the Index on Censorship and Amnesty International and all the other things I actually really, really like and really enjoy, and things that will sort of facilitate social change. So cuddling my inner hippie, I've managed to start making a living doing all this stuff, but primarily I'm still a journalist, and as a journalist what I do is ask questions, and be that through my pen or through a camera or even through some visual imagery and possibly taking over some illegal billboards and getting arrested for various other things, you know, it's still asking questions. That's fundamentally the only reason why I still do what I want to do, is because nobody's really managed to sufficiently answer them just yet. So without further ado, some nonsense with moving pictures and sound, I think.
No one's paying the blindest bit of attention.
No, I think that's a good thing, to be honest.
Is there anybody in that station?
Yeah.
I just wondered, you're not going to stick anything on me?
No, no, I make. Caught red-handed. I thought it was closed. Oh, dear.
Okay, over there is the vacuum cleaner. He's agreed to let me spend the day with him, essentially defacing Metropolitan Police logos.
On a Sunday afternoon, what else are you going to do, right?
Thank you for coming here today for the launch of the Free Syrian Air Force's first mission.
What's going on?
The Free Syria Air Force are a peaceful, secular collective disgusted with the terror unleashed by Bashar al-Assad on the Syrian people.
We're just making a little film.
About
solidarity with the Syrian people.
Solidarity with Syrian people, mm-hmm. All right.
We are showing solidarity with Syrian activists in Damascus who recently used creative direct action to show their contempt against the killing of their people.
And what's the film going to entail?
It's going to entail some paper aeroplanes.
Some paper aeroplanes.
And that's about it.
Although we are using planes, ours are made out of paper and the names of the dead. They are our way to throw these crimes against humanity back at the doors of the oppressor. This is in no way a call to warmongering Western governments to bomb or intervene in Syria. When you've launched as many as you can, balloons are going to be passed around to release a black cloud over the Syrian embassy.
Some people are calling for a Western military intervention. What these guys are doing is a peaceful,
artistic action in solidarity with the Syrian people.
Oh, this is the latest thing that I've been up to. I've managed to get banned by Twitter, thanks to Locog. I'm now actually an official Olympic protester. I think I might even have some of those things.
They're cool t-shirts.
Yes, thank you very much. Basically, the idea was to, because the Olympics obviously have the official condom, the official chocolate bar, the official drinks company, the official arms dealer, and the official apartheid supplier for the games, we decided to be the official protesters. So we made these and then branded our entire website and various little bits and bobs with it. Locog, the London Organising Committee, used a bit of legislation and got pissed off, complained to Twitter. Twitter banned us. Thanks to the Streisand effect, it got all over the world. A couple of days ago, I did an interview for Rolling Stone magazine about Olympic censorship and the censorship of free expression and sport, and the idea that the Olympics is nothing really more than a nice little ghetto and a private club for people to make a lot of money off literally the sweat of others. So, yeah, there we are.
Yeah.
So it's no Locog.
Thank you. An official Olympics protesters t-shirts are available on demand from asking the right place.
I wouldn't, and if you were to be more specific, we would get in legal trouble.
But I wouldn't. Yeah, I would have no idea who to ask. Obviously.
No.
That goes out to everyone who watches the tape in particular. So we're seeing activists on screen there, obviously, and that's all very good, but. I mean, Emily, you kind of hinted at something saying that, you know, you don't think of yourself as an activist filmmaker. But for this, for any of you, do you think that your filmmaking is in itself activism? Is it in itself an act of activism, if that's not a terribly worded phrase?
If I can just also clarify that the reason that it's annoyed me that in the last year people have started classifying me as an activist filmmaker is because it's belittling and patronizing to the work that I'm doing. Every instance that I'm thinking of has been somebody who's tried to marginalize the film by calling me an activist filmmaker. It undermines the validity of it in the way that that phrase is being used most of the time. So I tried to explain that, like, the reasons why I make films are largely the same, I discover, as the reasons why people I've met have become activists. And so I think that the distinction is actually a kind of weird and false one.
Yeah, but, I mean, would you say that people see a film like Just Do It and then are actually inspired to go out and do their own activism, and by, in a sense, then maybe you're a...
Well, yes, that has happened, and I have had people come up to me and tell me how they, you know, joined Frack Off after seeing the film and went and got, you know, and have done 3 arrestable actions since then, and that sort of stuff, which is, like, great, you know. That wasn't specifically why I set out to make the film, but I think that's great if that's having that effect. But equally, like, films that I made before this, like, you know, The Luckiest Nut, I made The Luckiest Nut because Tony Blair was going around saying that the way to save Africa was to liberalize trade, and I knew my economics enough to understand that that was simply not the case, and that it was actually the wrong way to be helping them. And I wanted to make a film that would make people question the next time they saw him say that, and I've actually had 2 people come up and tell me, you know, that they watched the film and then they understood the opposition to that policy. And so, you know, I think this is all this, it's all kind of part and parcel.
And I guess for you, Daniel, you know, particularly in the work you've done for UK and Kurt Callart videos, you know, that's very much filmmaking explicitly to get people to do something, you know, not just watch the screen and then switch it off.
Yeah, I mean, I've got written down like 5 different ways that we, you know, you can use film. I mean, you don't have to produce 2-hour feature-length films on activism. You know, film has been used to, you know, you can quickly film 2-minute protests. You can use film to create elaborate call-out videos, you know, rather than just sort of, you know, a Facebook post saying, come here, you know, produce a 2-minute sort of wow shebang, you know, that groups all around the world do, you know, and during the G8 years ago, you used to get German groups that made these complete riot porn call out videos. You get Al Qaeda make call out videos, and we do the same. But even the film that I've just made, it's still an extension of what I do every day, in that I'm trying to tell a story and I'm trying to communicate and I'm trying to tell things, and I've just chosen another way to do that, basically. The only reason I made that film was to try and change people's minds about something. So.
Cool, cheers. And what about you, Leah? Like, for example, those films that we just saw, you know, you're obviously documenting something really fun, really, something really fun. But are you explicitly thinking, oh, you know, people will see this and do their own versions of this?
That's entirely up to whoever watches it, but I can only hope that it opens up somebody's mind and headspace to actually think, hey, you don't have to show your dissatisfaction, show your dissent by writing a ranty article or trying to desperately cry to get onto Commenters Free. But you can do other things. You can think outside the box. You can be much more creative about your dissent. You can be much more creative about your art, your journalism. You don't have to stand outside with a placard somewhere and in the drizzling rain and feel utterly miserable. You can do something from the nice comfort, warmth of your own home and still affect quite a lot of change. Brian will obviously kind of come in later and talk about how a lot of people did exactly that with We Are Nation, or We Are
Legion.
Yeah. Legion, sorry, damn it.
Sure, and I think for all of you, the content of the work you make isn't, you know, let's call it, you know, protest porn or riot porn in particular. You've made riot porn.
I've done lots of riot porn. I mean, I've been shot and shit. So, and kicked out of countries and stuff. So, yeah, but, you know, that's one aspect of it, and that's obviously the slightly sexier aspect of it, and what draws quite a lot of testosterone-laden, egomaniacal, hubris-ridden young men towards being foreign correspondents, and at which point that it turns them into a slightly lecherous and misogynistic bastard. But, hello, Sheffield. That's not the only thing that can be done. I mean, even here, Sheffield itself is home to, I think, in the 1970s, there was a women's only workers' film collective and cooperative. There was another one in Leeds, and there's another one in London, and they had a fantastic sort of sense of fun and sense of the new when they were doing a lot of their work. And so it's not really so much about what, you know, drives you testosterone-wise towards a story. It's whether or not you actually think that your ideas or the questions that you ask can really facilitate some form of social change. Because if you're really pissed off about something, don't just whinge about it. Why don't you just do something about it instead?
Just do it.
Yeah,
just
do it. Exactly, yeah. And do you think that any of you, really, that documentary is explicitly well-served in sending out that call to action to people? And indeed filmmaking, as opposed to another art form or, you know, putting the camera down and doing something else?
Yes, because people don't want to read stuff, they want to watch stuff, primarily. I think there are limitations, though, when we actually... I mean, there's so many... I mean, what do we mean when we say call to arms? Who are we actually talking to? What are we proposing that people do? There are so many different groups of people in this world. Like, who are we actually talking to? Like, you know, for me, Emily's film was best placed at talking to maybe a group of people concerned about climate change and that maybe gave money to Greenpeace, and that the film was saying, do this instead. Mm-hmm. Emily wasn't talking to my mum. You know, my mum is not going to do that kind of thing. She, in fact, make her more likely not to want to ever do that, to be honest with you.
But, I mean, in a sense, you're right to say that the core people that we were trying to reach out and kind of show it to were people who understood that climate change was happening, were concerned about it, knew that we were causing it, maybe were frustrated with what they want. You know, but I disagree. I mean, I don't know your mother personally, but I actually, a lot of the kind of things that I hoped that the film would do would be to show to a wider community what the people that were doing direct action were like and get them to kind of get to know them and understand them, because when I got to know them, it changed the way that I viewed what they were doing. And so it's not, I don't see it as like a film whose goal is to get people out super gluing themselves to things. It's about repositioning that, direct action had been, was being incredibly vilified in the media, and the way that it was being reported I thought was incredibly inaccurate. And so it was about repositioning it
I definitely agree with you. But there's so many different groups. I think another problem with documentary is, that it, I don't think it actually gets seen as widely as we think it gets seen. Put it in independent cinemas that are quite expensive to get into. We then put a price tag on the DVD. And
these are £10, by the way, if you
I can give you the code to rip it if you like.
Yeah, it's available online.
It's on pirate.
There's special features, though. So, yeah. Anyway.
Can I jump in?
Yeah, go for it.
I think there are obviously issues of distribution and accessibility in documentary, but they go far beyond the price tag. But I think that the documentary is particularly well suited for this kind of area, and I think that that's because it's not just that people want to watch things because they're lazy and they don't want to read. It's actually that I think documentary can do something that almost nothing else can, because it can move people intellectually and emotionally at the very same moment. And that's something that is very rare and doesn't happen very often. So you can be taking somebody on an intellectual journey but also plugging at their heartstrings at the same time, which is, very, very powerful. And so it does, how many people you actually manage to do that to. I also think there have been some really fascinating studies about the cultural effect of documentaries, that although in numbers-wise these films might not actually be seen by that many people, they really punch above their weight when it comes to having cultural impact and having impact and changes on society. And so, I'm thinking of, when End of the Line came out. End of the Line was a film about the overfishing of the oceans, and they were lucky enough to get a large grant to study the effect of the film. They got a grant for more money than most of these films are made on, by the way. That's how much it took to really calculate it, but they really did a proper study. And one of the things that they found was that after it had been in the cinemas, that 8,000 people had been to see it in the cinemas, but 80,000 people had heard about the film at that point. And that was kind of interesting, that 80,000 people had been reached with the message. And then when they started going and counting the media impressions, how many times it had been mentioned in the newspapers and how many times, that was hugely significant. It had had so much airtime, it had gotten so much play for this issue that really was not getting a lot of attention before that. And they didn't, because that's a few years ago now, they didn't even measure any of the social media talk about it. So, I think you can make massive impacts with relatively small amount of resources.
Possibly, but it's also the one issue that sort of bothers me a lot about sort of documentary community and things like that is, and also the same thing that bothers me about the journalistic community, is this idea that you are impartial, or this false sense of impartiality. I'm not saying you said it.
But there is.
I am just saying that there is this idea that you have to be this other. And what I'm interested in is the space where observation itself is an intervention. So it's when you open up your lens, it's when you decide to make that cut, or what things you decide to put into something to actually make your narrative. I'm interested in that space. I'm also interested in the space where film itself is secondary to the actual narrative that's actually taking place, which is interpersonal communications, things that happen online, things that happen over on the ether, and all of these other discussions that happen. The film, to me, is just another way of illustrating a much bigger picture, and a much bigger picture that consists of real lives and consists of real life experiences and things that sweat and bleed and breed. But that's just my take on that.
I'm just going to jump in there.
Is this a Nick Fraser panel?
Yeah.
I was trying to work out when you were standing over there whether that was actually you or just a man that had come in the room and was looking at me. Which happens all the time when I'm doing panels. So,
men
so,
standing in corners. Like
yeah, men idea. Standing in corners wanted to be on a panel with me. Welcome to Brian Knappenberger, the director of Real Legion. You've just come straight from a screening of the
Q&A. Yes, I apologize. We had a screening that overlapped here, so we just finished our Q&A.
That's fine. Apologies for our terrible planning. it's great to have you here. The film is really awesome. Go and see it, everyone, if you haven't already. Tell us a bit about the film, a bit about yourself, and then we'll see a quick clip from it. And
right.
Carry on with
what
the
clip
discussion.
Do you have?
We'll see when we
We'll see. my film is called We Are Legion, The Story of the Hacktivists. Essentially, I look at hacktivism, which is loosely defined, using computer systems to make a political point. Often that means a sort of virtual sit-in, which is a denial-of-service attack, which some people think of as a virtual sit-in, which essentially shuts down a site for a short period of time. In another sense, that can be hacktivism can mean turning the internet back on with when repressive regimes try to shut it off. So we look at this as a kind of phenomenon, hacktivism. We go back to the 50s to kind of hacker culture. Hacktivism really takes off in the 90s with the internet and the invention of things like the Mosaic browser. And there was a bit of a kind of a lull in the early sort of 2000s, and it resurged in a fairly dramatic way in the last few years with a group that most people have heard of called Anonymous. So most of the film follows Anonymous, but we go back in time and look at hacktivism in general.
So just while we're loading that up, in terms of your own background, to have access to the hacktivists and win their trust, did you have some connection with them already?
Yes,
is this
I did.
Trailer okay to show?
How did I establish connection?
Well, I guess I'm just wondering whether your own background is in hacktivism and in this world, or whether it was a story you came across just because you were interested.
Well, I'm a documentary filmmaker. I've done lots of work for PBS Frontline, Discovery, National Geographic.
Yeah.
Just finished a series for Bloomberg. And I've been really interested in Anonymous for a while, and the kind of groups, the kind of online cultures that grew out, that from which Anonymous kind of emerged. They first really got on my radar when they organized attacks on the Church of Scientology in 2008. The group was upset by the Church of Scientology taking off, issuing cease and desist letters, DMCA violations to people that had seeded a video of Tom Cruise talking very elaborately and enthusiastically about the Church of Scientology. Maybe a lot of people have seen that. It went everywhere online, especially after the cease and desist letters. And and it became a joke. And as I have somebody saying in the film, that you don't take a joke away from Anonymous. So they roar into action, feeling this is perceiving this as a restriction of freedom of information online. And they organized protests that I think become some of the first protests, at least at that scale, ever organized online. It's definitely a moment of innovation. Over 10,000 people, 132 cities, 42 countries worldwide showed up on one day and surprised them. They were shocked. Yeah. They thought maybe, five people would show up. And it was the first time that we'd seen the internet call people into the streets in any kind of major way in order to protest. And I think it's become the model of protest since then. So anyway, that put them on my radar. I was on the back of my mind for a long time because it was weird, right? Here's a group protesting a church that was created by a science fiction author wearing masks. Created by a science fiction. these are two strange groups, in a way. So, the documentary snapped in in 2010 when they attacked the MasterCard, Visa, and PayPal, when those companies cut off financial services to WikiLeaks, and they started a rampage that's lasted about a year and a half, and we've been following them ever since.
Cool.
Yeah.
Let's watch the trailer.
The computer hacker group Anonymous is claiming tonight that it took down the website of the Federal Appeals Court in San Francisco this afternoon.
They took down Senate.gov servers. They've taken down H.B. Gary. Sony's claiming they did $150 million worth of damage.
So many confidential files that tonight, because of these hackers, can be in the hands of anyone.
Visa, MasterCard, the PayPal situation.
See, criminals who hacked into Sarah Palin's private email.
The Church of Scientology says Anonymous is a cyber terrorist group of religious bigots.
Anonymous and this other group called Lulz Sec. They seem to be wanting to prove a point.
Anonymous kind of was like the big, strong, buff kid who had low self-esteem. And then all of a sudden punched somebody in the face and was like, holy shit, I'm really strong. Anonymous calls itself the final boss of the internet, and sometimes it proves to be really fucking true. If you are going to violate the freedoms of the internet, you certainly better watch the fuck out.
They are kind of the rude boys of activism. There's a real rough edge to them, which I think also is one reason why they garner so much love and hate from people, too. They represent a certain sort of chaotic freedom.
The hacker ethos has a passion for truth. It wants what's real to be out there. And it uses kind of the Philip K. Dick definition of reality. And reality is that which, when you stop believing in it, refuses to go away.
We stand for freedom. We stand for freedom of speech, the power of the people, the ability for them to protest against the government, to right wrongs. No censorship, especially online, but also in real life.
We have members throughout society and all strata of it worldwide, yet we have no leadership.
It's a one voice. It's not individual voices. That's why we don't show our faces. That's why we don't give our names. We're speaking as one, and it's a collective. Good timing.
So the FBI shows up at 6 in the morning and they drag me out into the cold and there's guns and the little LED flashlight in the vest. It was really obnoxious. If you so much as sneeze on someone's tablet and the government's not happy about it, then you're a hacker.
There's people that are dying for a flag and they're being lied to. And maybe it's time for a new law. If I get the chance to do that, then so be it. And if 14 other people that are with me get the chance to do it, then so be it.
You want to see Anonymous rise up? Try to shut down the message. Try to squash the message. Try to chill our speech. Then you'll see what Anonymous can do.
Right now, you could argue that the most powerful people on Earth are a bunch of nameless, faceless 17 to 35-year-olds. It's like the hacker ruling class, right?
It's my community. It's my culture. I identify with Anonymous.
Whether they had a tiny, tiny part, or they had a substantive part in the Arab Spring or toppling of Tunisia and Egypt, Egyptian governments. Individual, young, nameless, faceless folks are having geopolitical impact. It's both exhilarating to realize that and terrifying to realize that. It kind of depends on how that power is wielded.
So, I mean, what I really love about the film is that it fits in with something Emily was saying earlier about making the film because in the mainstream press, activists were being demonized and not actually being able to get their own message out. And, you know, hacktivism in particular is so completely demonized by the mainstream media. And yeah. I think your film very much puts a human face on it and just shows that, you know, these are just, you know, quite nice people, really. Yeah. Very committed
nice,
people.
Nice, I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think that was the point, really. You know, there's been a lot of news stories about Anonymous that talk about them as being terrorists and criminals and hooligans. And I think there's value in sitting down and saying, well, who are they? What do they want? And sort of listening to their story. So that was really the kind of point.
Well, and we were talking a little earlier about like how to get these films out to people, mm-hmm. and you know, making sure that they're watched and that people actually react to them. And in your release strategy for it, are you trying to get to hacktivists, trying to get to an audience who are particularly interested in it, are you also trying to get to a general audience and have a wider ripple?
Definitely general audience as well as people in both in Anonymous and the sort of wider internet community. But I think I'd love my film to be seen by everybody.
I only want a small number of people to watch my film.
Yeah.
But I think it is an important thing to discuss in terms of these films, because there is a fear that this kind of film will only be seen by activists, and it won't. And we were talking a little about that earlier, that it won't go beyond the people who are already kind of, you know, small liberal clique who are already interested in it.
Yeah, I think that there is something about this that people are, maybe it's the anonymity, maybe it's the kind of the mask, the kind of mysteriousness of it. One of the things as a subject that's so interesting about Anonymous is their theatricality and their humor. And they're kind of geniuses at getting the message out. So to sort of sit back and kind of analyze that, I think there's something there that's beyond the, you know, that's almost a tool, humor as a tool, you know. The lulls, which started as a kind of prankster, a pranksterism, became a kind of tool in a way.
So.
Yeah, it's a lot easier to engage people if you can crack a joke about a goatsy than it is to just hammer home lots of very worthy points. I mean, the worthy points are very, very good, and they really, really should be there. And that should be like the underlying bed and that very serious message. But if you can think of a nice, novel, innovative way to actually engage people by playing with their sense of humour, playing with their sense of fun, making them feel like they're part of something naughty, part of something that a lot of other people are part of, and there's like that whole sort of collective identity, then you start succeeding, and you don't start looking like, you know, the weirdo in the sandals standing outside Haggerston Station. But
hold on, I live next to Haggerston Station.
Yeah, well,
is it you?
But I think there's also another thing about humor, because I really love using humor in films, because it, when you make people laugh, they open their mind as well. Like if you make somebody laugh, they can laugh at themselves, they can acknowledge something they couldn't acknowledge in any other emotional way, they can, you know, and suddenly you kind of crack people open and you get them to look at things from a different perspective, which is kind of, in, you know, certainly the point of a lot of these films.
Some that plays into Anonymous is that some people in Anonymous are very careful about the use of illegal tactics, and especially the use of denial of service attacks, which essentially overwhelm a server with packets and fake information, basically like shutting it down. And I've heard a lot of people say, well, you know, when we do that, people pay attention to what we really want to say. So. And a lot of times that ends up being a kind of carefully tactical move that people make, knowing in some cases, you know, they're breaking law and they could face very serious prison time for that.
Mm. And of course, for all of you, you are depicting illegality on screen, obviously, and I guess with that comes a certain amount of responsibility towards the people that are on screen. Do any of you want to kind of talk a bit about the responsibility you feel towards the protesters that you have on screen?
Well, I mean, I think, making Just Do It was very difficult, but probably the thing that, you know, just added the whole layer of complication was the fact that I was asking people to do something that could potentially be very incriminating for them. And I was, you know, pretty determined that my footage wouldn't be used against them. And, you know, went to great lengths to make sure that didn't happen. And one of the things, I mean, there are many things that I did, but one of the things, and I think one of the key things in my relationship with the people that I was filming with, was I had a safe house location where all of the footage was being kept, and I was the only person that knew where the safe house was, that was very important, because I had made it clear that I wouldn't tell the authorities where the footage was, no matter what they threw at me legally and that I would be prepared to go to jail and have a custodial sentence if that was the case, because that was the agreement that I had with the people that I was filming with. And in a way, that put my neck first on the line, and I think it allowed them to trust me a lot more because they could see that I wasn't asking them to take a risk that I wasn't prepared to take first and foremost myself. Mm. But that was... I was scared to death the entire year that I was filming. And like, you know, I had a conscious like weight on my shoulders of the, you know, 6 months before I started filming, a filmmaker that had been working with the Smash Edo campaign in Brighton had their house raided, all their equipment confiscated, their child taken to school in a police car, like, you know, really brutal stuff. And so I had that in the back of my mind the whole time. Mm. But it was incredibly important that they have the people participating in the film were protected from the potential of it coming, you know, back to harm them.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I just don't think that it's really, personally, there's a case of us and them. Mm. You're kind of all in this together. And one of the things I sort of scribbled down here is, you know, it's one of the lines I actually fed to the vacuum cleaner in that film was, if the law is an ass, you've got to kick it. And free speech itself is what you are doing is you're documenting things and you're reporting things, and you know, you have a job and you have a very important use and a tool. And free speech is not illegal; it is a human right. And you know, I will fight for a member of Al-Qaeda or the BNP to have the right to say what they want to say. I won't necessarily agree with it, but I will fight for their right to say it, and then I'll break their legs.
But I'm not necessarily going to use my time and resources to help amplify their message. I don't think they should be stopped from saying the thing.
No.
But I think that's where I kind of stand on it.
But that's your
I put my time and resources into helping amplify messages that I'd like more people to hear. And yeah. You know, and not ones that I'd like less people to hear.
Yeah.
Mm. You're very quiet.
Yeah. Okay. I agree. I have a particular question for you, actually, Daniel. Coming more from starting as an activist, and particularly in the UK Uncut perspective, because UK Uncut protests are so extensively documented because they're in big public spaces. Did you or do you worry about the amount of that material being used against you? Not, I mean, both in legal terms, but also against you in documentary terms and in news reports that actually end up distorting the nature of UK Uncut protests?
I mean, not so much about the news stuff, just because that's what you expect.
Mm.
In terms of, like, obviously, the biggest concern is the police and private security, mm. more so private security than the police. There was a period of 3 months where myself and a few others had to change our SIM cards every week. We had the most bizarre goings on with private security firms. You know, and the police, to be honest, they didn't really care about... I mean, at one point, it looked like the police were beginning to crack down, what with Fortnum and Mason, but it was private security employed by the companies that were the biggest problem. And the problem with private security is that they're not accountable, so a private security guard scares me far more than a police officer. And, you know, so they're looking, you know, as we saw from Chris Atkins' documentary, a few weeks ago on Channel 4, all they need is a photo and a name. And that's it. They can go and get what the hell they like, and they can really fuck you over. So yeah, of course. But you know, that doesn't mean that you cannot put the information out there. What I don't like in the movement is that culture of don't film us. Hiding away. Mm. For me, it's you've just got to put yourself out. You've got to accept it and just say, look, you know, it doesn't outweigh people not hearing your message or not seeing your actions, and so.
Yeah, I mean, there are circumstances that, and particularly in some of the other things I am involved with, that I don't necessarily tack my name onto, but where if you do have a person's name or face or a relative of theirs on screen, that Syria film was quite interesting because there were people there who I couldn't utterly identify or totally identify, and there were people we had to cut out because they have
family connections within Syria and within other Middle Eastern regimes. And being someone who's been to some of those countries and other places, the people you speak with, you have to develop a very long, off-the-record sense of trust with them. So you develop a kind of relationship. You give something of your own life to them so they can give you something back. And so it becomes a reciprocal agreement. And when it becomes a reciprocal agreement, you're not just documenting or using somebody's story as a soundbite or a grab. You're messing with somebody who's your friend. You know, you're messing with somebody's real life here. And, you know, these people can end up with a bullet through their head. They can end up missing. You know, some of that stuff's happened in my own family, thanks to Ferdinand Marcos. So I kind of know the real and true impacts of what somebody can say carelessly in the press, or can say carelessly in a magazine article or in a television report, or just by taking a tourist photograph. And suddenly somebody's face turns up, and then they become a target, and suddenly that person goes missing. And so you really do have to be very, very careful. So when, you know, obviously on one angle you have activists within, I would say, privileged Western environments, who, yes, the sense of terror is definitely real, and the sense of terror is definitely there. And then you have that accentuated in much more oppressive regimes, where that sense of terror is fatal and lethal. And, you know, that's where you have to be really careful.
I can maybe just add to that. But I agree. I think you do whatever you can to protect your sources. Yeah. I mean, if don't do this. Do something else with your life. You know, Anonymous is interesting. He's saying the covering of the face. That you know, the case for anonymity, I think, in protesting online, Anonymous is a kind of natural reaction to a lot of times civil disobedience groups in the 60s, 70s, we can all name plenty of examples, where the leader's been taken out and there's been chaos. So Anonymous is a reaction to that, a kind of post 9/11 reaction to that, where there's intrusion and surveillance now in our lives. So this notion of decentralized movements, of leaderless groups, this is a reaction to that kind of thing, and using that as a kind of a key kind of tool.
Mm. Well, that's interesting, though. It's also coming. I hadn't thought about that particular explanation. But I mean, it's tied so closely to a kind of a broadly speaking anarchist tradition, which is kind of, you know, informs all of the groups that I was filming with for Just Do It, and you know, and the desire, you know, that's a practical. It's an interesting practical reason why it's helpful to not have leadership, but that's not the ideological reasons for why they don't have the hierarchical leadership.
I think to some degree it is. Yeah. I mean, you're saying that practically they're just trying not to get arrested, basically.
No. Yeah. I'm saying that they have deeper ideological reasons for resisting a hierarchy and not wanting leaders than just practical reasons.
I think that's true too. Yeah. Yes, yeah. Absolutely. But there's also that as a reaction to the way other civil disobedience groups have been, taken out.
Yeah, but if you take kind of like a military adage to it, I mean, instead of putting a leader or a particular person or Salvador Allende between the crosshairs, you just go and nuke the whole place. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what they can. That's what can be done. So instead of just identifying individuals and then picking them out and hope the mass crumbles, and that's what they tried to do with Fortnum and Mason and UK and Cut and everything else, is literally just scare the living shit out of you by either convicting you or sending you to jail, giving you the threat of ruining the rest of your life, and yeah, like literally by doing that, or they can just try to firebomb the entire movement by these big one fell.
That's actions. True, and we are seeing more wide sweeping internet kind of restrictions, but which is highly protested by Anonymous. Another tactic that law enforcement has used is, which is tried and true in the United States, is the informant. The kind of infiltrator or agent provocateur. Yeah. And we've seen that a lot in Anonymous in the last year.
Definitely. And the activist community here has witnessed more or less the same thing, you know.
Someone's got a waving hand.
They're telling us to get out of here.
I just wanted to make one practical suggestion for anybody who wants to make films about things or activists who have filmmakers visiting them. There is a law in the UK where a lot of protest offences are summary-only offences, which means that they have to be only tried by a judge, and the law states that you can't be charged with that offence if it happened after 6 months of the action. So, for instance, in Emily's film, by the time that the film came out, a lot of the offences, they couldn't have, you can't then arrest somebody for an offence they did.
That doesn't apply to conspiracy, though, and conspiracy was the most likely thing that my footage would have been used to prove. Mm. And in fact, that was the reason why people, one of the reasons why people were scared was because conspiracy, so the lack of leadership, the authorities are constantly trying to figure out who planned this action, who are the leaders of this action, right? Mm-hmm. And often there would be people who were like involved at a planning stage and had some information and shared some information but didn't do the action, and the footage could really easily be misinterpreted to suggest that they had put everybody up to it and that they were the leader or the instigator or something like that. And that was a kind of certainly a big problem. Like, there were meetings that I filmed that if you took them in the wrong way or didn't understand the full context, could have been, they could have attempted to use that to prosecute people for conspiracy, and and that's how they could get jail time as well. So there are some things that are safe and some things that are not, you know. And we hired, or engaged, we didn't pay them, lawyers to represent the activists who were in the film. And when they looked at the final cuts of the film, they identified a whole long list, as long as your arm, of offences that people in the film were committing in the film and could still be prosecuted for up to, quite a few years after the film went out. So, we're relatively clear. They've not gone after anybody. And all of those offences were, they were told to the people and they were detailed out to them what they could pretend. But the lawyers also said, look, we don't have any reason to believe that there's any political will to come after you for these things at this moment in time. And, they gave them some really good advice.
You can also, what I know you've done, and what I do, is I also tack on, I've photographed the camera, special procedure material. And so under the Police and Criminal Evidence Act of 1984, you basically say that this is material, the media, the material itself, and everything else that's gathered with it, and what you're holding is a piece of news gathering equipment. And so, if they actually want you or want to take it off you, they're going to have to go and go to a court. And
they need a court order. And you can mark your tapes with Section 61, and you can do it. You can't, but all you need is a court order to look at that material, and all you need is a court order to take it away from you. And I was in a situation where I was filming for long enough that they knew what I was doing, and a court order would have been incredibly easy for them to attain, and there was no precedent for what would happen after that, and for whether, and how that material would be used. I mean, there are also other things, like, my material would have been quite difficult to use in court because I don't date stamp it. I'm not talking over the top of it to give them evidence. It's very poor evidence. It would have been relatively easy for the defense lawyers to rip it apart as evidence, but that would be already when we were in the courts, and nobody wanted to get to that point, and that wasn't, so the point was to avoid that rather than kind of, fight it when it,
Was that an intentional decision not to date stamp it, or
Well, you don't want to date stamp your material. I mean, I actually did accidentally date stamp one of the shoots, but that was a mistake. No, it's just I don't know if you've seen this, but the police walk around during protest situations, and the forward intelligence unit points a camera at everybody, and then they've got one of them standing next to him going, he's wearing a green shirt and blue trousers, and da da da. That's the level of hard evidence, and they know who took that, they have the officer's name, that, that's the, you have to really be robust enough to stand up in court against somebody. You can't be able to go, well, we don't know when she started and stopped recording, what was missing here, what was missing there. It's just not very strong evidence. But that didn't stop the people that I was filming with from having very valid concerns about how this material might be used against them, and that wasn't going to necessarily stop the authorities from trying to take it away.
Again, as Dan has said before, fit team, come hell, high water, be damned, because fit team is just the police, actually. It's just the UK police. It's just the Metropolitan Police or whoever else. What concerns me are demonstrations outside places like the Bahraini Embassy or the Syrian Embassy, where people are being observed and people are being watched.
Yeah.
And people outside the Belarusian embassy, or anybody who goes to any functions over there, things to do with Azerbaijan. These are the repressive regimes that you really have to seriously watch out for, because there are people very, very far away who speak a very different language to you, who are a different colour to you, who can get slotted because of what you might be doing or who you might be capturing or everything else. And that to me is of more concern than what the fucking police in this country can do, because I can fight them.
Oh, well, actually, I don't know, because I was going to say that don't assume that rule of law or the absence of rule of law is something over there far away, because in Copenhagen they completely just said, actually for the next few months, not all those laws that we've applied to all of this, they just said that we're going to suspend all of
that. They can do all that to you,
they
but
can hold,
if,
yep.
if they try to put a fucking bullet in your head, they know they've got something to answer
right,
for.
Right, but I'm just saying that, we can't assume that the current situation and rule of law will apply in a year's time, because, in Copenhagen, they completely changed all the rules of the game and took away, I had my material confiscated, I was physically expelled from a building for the crime of having a press card, I had, all of the, rules that should have applied didn't apply, and suddenly we were, in a completely, there was no rule of law at all, and that could have happened from the beginning of filming, started filming Just Do It. I didn't know where we would be politically at the point when I finished filming, nor where we would be by the time the film came out. And you have to future-proof yourself against it.
But then you have that rule of law, then you have a film like Alison Clayman's I Weigh Way, Never Sorry, or I want to kind of vandalize the posters, Never Solly. But, and there you also have a complete absence of the rule of law within China. Because, not only have they managed to kind of successfully, instead of trying to get two films pulled from the Sheffield program here, they decided, instead of banning those films, they just go and ban themselves, which baffles the imagination. But again, it's when you have a documentary filmmaker actually making these sort of things and putting these things out into the world, and thank you Streisand Effect, because had they not arrested him for alleged tax evasion last year, he and this film and all of this stuff wouldn't even be out there. So, China's fantastic at being able to shoot themselves in the PR foot for that. But yeah, when we were talking about that absence of rule of law, yes, Copenhagen was something, but I would have been really, really, really shocked if they would, let's say, try to keep you under house arrest or try to make you go missing or try to make any of those...
They made Danish citizens go missing and kept them under house arrest during the entire
protest
period.
I'm talking
about
you go missing or anything of that,
Yeah!
Yeah.
If you see the film, I didn't go down lightly.
No, there was a really awesome bit where basically she was doing this really lovely kind of hey, yeah, I'm just going to hug my producer. Yeah, hug. What was she doing? Passing on a tape. Yeah.
So clever.
It was awesome.
Yeah. It was very cloak and dagger.
Yes.
And I've noticed the time. Let's open it out to the audience, because we've seen a couple of hands waving out there. So the lady in the green...
Thanks. My name is Kate, and Emily knows me, and I think you do too.
Okay.
Hi. I'm also been a long-term activist and getting into filmmaking, and have also done citizen journalism through Vision on TV, which distributes online the kinds of videos that people make when they're out and about, documenting social issues, environmental, political issues, and whatnot. And that's got a no-edit rule. And the reason for that is because filmmaking takes a really long time, and so I just wanted to raise the question or put the issue in your minds. If you're thinking of using documentary for activism, maybe also think, is that the right thing for you to do? Because making a film does take a long time. Maybe you want to do something a bit shorter, no editing or short editing, get it up on the day, move on, and do something the next day. So that's another way of being an activist using film footage. And it kind of, I just wanted to sort of just, I suppose, share the idea that for me, activism, just a simple model is the three A's. It's awareness raising, attitude changing, and action. And so, just the idea of how far documentary, what you need to do to ensure that your documentary is leading to a change in action, as well as raised awareness and some attitude change. I just wanted to raise the issue of the idea that your film can be co-opted. A couple of years ago, I was at Sheffield, and Age of Stupid was speaking. Of course, a fantastic film and an amazing campaign came out of it, which was 10/10. But at that time, I was working for a local council, and I shared with the directors the fact that their film and their campaign was being used by my local council to pretend they were doing something about climate change. And so kind of just to be very savvy if you're using your filmmaking and activism to make sure that you are politically aware enough of the context for the issue to then go on and do campaigning around it. And if you're not, to make sure that, and by the way, this is not, I'm not for a second saying Age of Stupid wasn't politically savvy, because they certainly are, but I just know that was going on in my council, to link up with the right organisations or groups that, you know, have that long-term sophisticated knowledge around activism and political change to ensure that your film isn't being used, your campaign isn't being used in a way that possibly could even cause harm. Sorry, one other issue, and I'll give it back. So if I'm a person and I'm watching a film, I've never done activism, and I'm having my awareness raised and I'm feeling my attitude change, I just was wondering about the idea of really indicating to people where to go and what to do when you leave the film. So do you feel when you make your films that you, I mean, is it appropriate to be sticking something on the end that's got websites? Or, I mean, how do you actually link, how do you push someone towards a specific action so they actually do something after seeing your film? And do you think that's your responsibility? That's one of my questions.
And Daniel, do you want to answer that? You're not.
I mean, I guess the thing about sort of pure raising awareness documentaries is that they don't ever provide a direction and an avenue from which people can take their anger into any form of political action, which...
That's a strong word. I know I can think of five counter-examples of somewhere.
Okay.
we'll come to them in a minute.
which I think... I don't think, you know, every film has to end with, like, now here, take action at the following website, join this group. But the good thing about, you know, films like Emily's film is that clearly, you know, the whole film is about a group of people and it's quite clear how to get involved throughout the film. But certainly on the film I just made, you know, there's websites at the end, things like that. I mean, absolutely, like the credits of the film in the very least can be full of websites, places where you can get involved. You know, at the end of the day, like if you've made a film about a group of people that risk their lives or, you know, put themselves out there, do a lot of work for free, and they've got a bigger vision of what they're trying to do, and if you don't ever pay credit to that by directing people into that movement, then I think that's kind of lame.
And it's also kind of like just saying that people aren't stupid, because there are two really solid films which I've seen at this festival. One was Fire in the Blood and the other one was Five Broken Cameras. Now, sitting here, I do feel a bit like a pretender to the crown, because when you're talking about whether or not filmmakers can be activists, particularly with regard of Imad and Five Broken Cameras, he is the real deal. I mean, he had five cameras broken through various periods over the span of 5 years. You see this, his son and everything else, you know, fighting the wall, this apartheid wall that's separating, Palestine, I think is what we're going to call it from now on. And, you know, he doesn't leave a little website at the end saying, hey, if you, you know, here's my three major points. But what he has done is he's just shown his life and shown what happens in front of the camera, and it gets you so fucking pissed off that you are not an idiot. If you want to find out about what's really going on in the Middle East, you will go to Google, or you will go to another place that kind of curates your knowledge, or you will ask people, or you will find out. And you know, you don't have to spoon-feed an audience a lot of this information and a lot of how they can do it. You just show them what it is. You know, here's the truth, it's on a plate. Do with it as you will. I mean, you can choose to ignore it and call it utter bullshit, or you can get really angry and decide to do something about it in your own way.
But one thing I would say about that, in an international context, it's quite difficult for people to relate to what they can do if you're not engaged in an issue and you see something going on in Palestine, it's not immediately aware what you personally can do sitting in the UK. And I think is quite important in a film is to somehow try and show people who are acting to change things. And I guess in an international context it's very difficult, but one thing that could be done maybe is if you are going over to make a documentary about some faraway land, is to maybe try and at least in some point in the film refer to groups maybe that are closer to home who are trying to act in solidarity with that over there. And I think people just people need to relate to people if they're to act and change. What I liked about Emily's film was that the three main characters are quite relatable people. They're people that you can sort of identify yourself with. People don't want to look at people and go, well, they're crazy or they're mad. Or, you know, I can never be like them. It's not going to induce change.
Let's go to another question. Lots of hands. Well, let's work around. Actually, because we haven't got that long, let's take a couple at once and stack them up, and then we'll try and respond to them. So let's go to the lady in a hat, and then the other two people on that row. So we'll take three at once.
Better get out the notebook.
Hello.
Can we try and keep them short and make it a question rather than a comment, if possible?
Okay, I'll stick to a question then. It was to Emily.
No worries.
Who's not listening? Hello, Emily. Hello.
Emily.
Someone's talking. I'm just about to embark on a project which deals with like issues regarding access, law, and all the rest of the shebang. And I'm struggling to. They don't want to be filmed. They're having infights and all the rest of it. But you said that you got kind of like around it because like you were prepared to like lay your life on the line. And just had a thought for 30 seconds. And yes, I am prepared to go to jail for the stuff that I'm filming. But how did you get it in writing to say that you were going to put yourself in jail? I mean, how did they believe you that you were going to do it?
That's quite a specific question, but let's take the next two on that row.
Hi, I'm Trasa. I'm working for Open City DocFest, and we're doing a whole strand actually next week called Protest Works, looking at movements and protests of the last year around the world specifically, and we're doing a session on the Real Social Network and Occupy movements and stuff as well. And I guess, you know, and this has been partly instigated by me and a few other people in the team as well. And I guess I'm thinking a lot, and I'm also a filmmaker. And this question here is looking at me for the last hour: can filmmakers be activists? And I'm thinking, can activists be filmmakers? Vice versa. And I'm like, well, what is a film, or what's it supposed to do? And these ideas about like campaign films really piss me off, I have to say, even though I appreciate them for what they try to do, but as an activist, but as a filmmaker, I don't. I find them like they're a turnoff or whatever. They're just like that's not engaging as a film. That's not a work of art. That's not doing anything different. It's giving me information, but I can get information from other places. So I feel, I don't know, even though this is kind of good, I feel like we're skirting around the question a bit. I'm going to ask it again, basically.
Okay, cool. So let's go across here. Let's catch the next one. Yeah, you. Yes.
Hi, my name is Arash. I'm coming from Iran. I live in Austria. We have a project called Everyday Rebellion, and I just wanted to invite people to join us. It's collecting different methods of nonviolent rebellion worldwide, and it's going to be a cinema documentary and also an application and so on. So I give you these cards later. But
I'll forgive you. It's out there now.
Thanks, Charlie.
Okay. Well, let's. Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah.
Shall I? Are we taking another one?
Okay, let's take another one.
We need questions.
Please make it a question. One sentence. Question.
Yeah, hi, my name's Saf. I'm a Syrian activist. I run an online campaign, Voices for Syria. I just wanted to ask, what do you think the future is of kind of documentary activism? And do you think that citizen journalism is, or what do you think is more... effective citizen journalism or documentary kind of activism?
Ooh, hard question. Can we go to that question first and then we'll work backwards through them, because I think that's quite an interesting talking point. Oh, another one. Wow. This is quite a lot
of questions.
I've
forgotten the first question, though.
Can we try and answer that question? otherwise we'll run out of time and not have any answers. So can we address that question of what the future of documentary activism is?
Well, I mean, I don't think they're oppositional things. I think they're really, you know, that we don't have to choose, thankfully. We can have both of them. So I don't know if you came to the talk before this that was in here with Tim Poole talking about live casting from Occupy Wall Street. And that, you know, that's a real amazing new
kind of totally unmediated, like really, completely raw. It's crazy. And, you know, and I love...
These are tools that cost, like, you know, $150,000 3 years ago.
Exactly. You know, yeah. And we're now so enabled and so, you know, and it's fascinating. And I think that citizen journalism and, or we, you know, whatever we call that, you know, I think that will, that'll feel like an old word in a year's time, but we, you know, whatever comes out of that, it's something that's really amazing. But I think that it... I'm going to kind of pull it together with the other question about kind of activists come filmmakers or filmmakers turn activists or what's going on there. I think personally, and maybe why I slightly, like, when people call me an activist filmmaker now, I kind of go, ugh, I don't like that. And I think that that's because if all you're doing in the film is trying to, like, push a specific agenda, it's difficult to get any kind of sense of depth or humanity in that message, you know? Yeah. You get this monotone, kind of beat you over the head with a sledgehammer kind of filmmaking, which really isn't filmmaking, you know?
I totally agree with this.
And so I think that that's where I hope that as a filmmaker and somebody who has, you know, experience and training, and I've, like, thought about it a lot and I've tried it quite a few times and I've fucked up and I've made bad films and I've made good films and I've, you know, and so, like, I've been exercising those storytelling muscles a lot longer than the average person who happens to find themselves in a situation where there's something that needs to be documented and filmed. And so, you know, that, and so, like, citizen journalism is limited by those individual people. Like, so citizen journalism works really well when you have large numbers of people with cameras to get covering lots of things, and then you can have the swarm effect, and a bigger truth comes out of that. And it doesn't matter if the skill level or the storytelling techniques of any individual person, you're not relying on them quite so heavily. And, you know, equally, I think documentary, at its best, presents a slightly more complex but, you know, delivered to you in a good, solid narrative sense. And shall I speak to the question of that? I'd say come and speak to me separately, and I can talk to you, like, more specifically about how to kind of work with it. But the main thing about how did I get them to believe me is I got to know them. We became, like, you know, it's not even, like, it's cliche to say we became friends, but, like, we did. Like, it got to a point where it wasn't about, am I going to sell, can you trust me not to sell you out, or can you, you know, it was like, you know, they knew where I lived, and, you know, it wasn't like, so I think I gained actual real trust with people and confronted their concerns really, rather than trying to skirt around them or get around them. I actually hit them head on and talked them through with them.
Let's go to another round of questions. Are there more hands out there? Yeah, let's go to... Okay, and then we'll take this one down here. I think those are two. And then, ideally one sentence questions, and then we'll come to the panel.
This is to Emily, about Creative Commons. I got an email a few days ago about it being released. So activists as filmmakers, are you going to be doing that with the filmmaking... God, I'm falling asleep on this one, so it's been a long day. Distribution, you're going to disrupt and occupy distribution by using Creative Commons with Just Do It. Can you fill us in with what that is and what legal frameworks and all that kind of stuff? So.
Cheers. And then question in the front row, down here, just down here to my left.
Hi, thank you all for a great, exciting panel. I work with Cinema Politica, and we screen exactly the type of films that you guys make, so thanks a lot for... you know, opening up to us. I'm just thinking the activist, filmmaker. I was just wondering what your thoughts are on the role of documentary filmmakers in empowering their subjects.
Ah.
Big question.
It's a good one. First off, can filmmakers be activists and can activists be filmmakers? I'm just going to chuck both of those words into the bin and just call you all journalists, because ultimately that's what I do. That's what we're all doing. You know, we tell stories, but we're still, you know, we're giving them facts, and you tell it. You're going who, what, when, where, why, and how. Those are the fundamentals of journalism. Those are the fundamentals of factual storytelling. Disagree with me if you like, Emily. I know you will. But you can shut up. And when you're talking about sort of the start again. Empowering your subjects. It brings me back to a film that was made by the Berwick Street Collective back in the 70s called Night Cleaners. And this was about a bunch of female cleaners, very shortly, who struggled and fought to be unionized. And Berwick Street Collective came out of something called Cinema Action. Mark Carlin was part of this whole thing. And it was a case of telling stories so that these people who otherwise would not have had this voice suddenly managed to get themselves out there. And eventually, you know, you as a filmmaker or as a journalist are nothing more than a conduit for a story. You're this little tunnel between this subject here and then this audience here. And this is you, and that's all that you are. And if you think of yourself anything greater than that, then well, maybe you should shut up.
And as a final point, does one of you want to address the question about Creative Commons and the use of that?
Well, yeah. Mark was actually asking something very specific, which is great because it reminded me that I forgot to hit this as a lead into the plug that I was supposed to make, because we're releasing Just Do It online towards the end of this month, I think the 26th of this month, and we're doing a kind of, it's a bit of an experiment because we're releasing a Creative Commons copy of the film, so that'll be free to share with each other and to share on peer-to-peer sharing sites like Pirate Bay and, you know, and other BitTorrent sites, and in fact we're placing it there and seeding it there and having a kind of mobilizing campaign to get people to seed it and, you know, kind of to work on that. And then on the very same day that we're doing that, we're also releasing it online, streaming and download to paid for on a variety of different platforms, including off of our own website. We've kind of struggled. We wanted initially to release the film only under a Creative Commons license and to not charge for it and to not commercialize it. But we also wanted people to give us donations in much larger sums than they ended up doing. So we weren't in a position to do that. That was essentially what we did when we were crowdfunding. We said, if we raise enough money through crowdfunding, we will give the film away for free. And we raised some money through crowdfunding, and we're giving some of the film away for free.
We're out of time there. There's so much more to discuss, but we have to end it here. But maybe people will be around a little longer for any more questions people want to come for them. So thanks to the panel. It's been great. It's been fun. Enjoy the rest of DocFest.